One sports a smile, the other a sneer. One is smooth, polished, the other rough and abrasive. One is motivated by love for a deceased mother. The other burns on a flame of hatred for the father who left him as a baby. One forces the action in a straight-ahead assault. The other reacts to his opponents with deft counterpunches. So different, yet so similar, for both are undefeated and among the very best fighters in the world. Tonight, James Toney, the IBF super middleweight champion, and Oscar De La Hoya, one of boxing's brightest prospects, share center stage. Angeles, California, HBO Sports presents World Championship Boxing. First, James Toney defends his IBF super middleweight crown against number one ranked contender Tim Little. Then hometown favorite Oscar De La Hoya beats WBO junior lightweight titleist Jimmy Bridal. Both fights scheduled for 12 rounds. It's the kind of arena they just don't build anymore. Ever since the Olympic Auditorium opened its doors in 1925, virtually every great boxing name has graced its marquee. And like the many ring warriors who have managed to survive within this building's four walls, the Olympic has also had to sustain itself through some years of hard times. But instead of having been demolished like so many other older arenas, the Olympic has now undergone a total restoration. And tonight, the tradition continues in this historic structure as we host the first boxing event to be held in the brand new Grand Olympic Auditorium. Tonight, four undefeated fighters serve in effect as supporting actors to the real star of the show, one of the truly storied venues in the long history of this sport. Good evening, everybody. I'm Jim Lampley. We welcome you to this occasion on which we continue to follow the developing careers of IBF super middleweight champion James Toney and of lightweight title contender Oscar De La Hoya, both of whom are looking toward victories and moving on toward bigger and better things tonight, but also to celebrate the reopening of this terrific venue, one of the truly storied places ever to have hosted boxing matches. Working with me, as always, is another Los Angeles resident, longtime HBO boxing analyst Larry Merchant. Larry, is it possible that with Oscar De La Hoya as the spearhead, this building can be returned to its glory days?
That would be a hard one, even if De La Hoya is as good as he thinks he is, and he thinks he's pretty good. But Barb Arum is an intrepid entrepreneur, says he's going to promote two fights a month, and judging from the crowd tonight, if De La Hoya can fight in enough of them, who knows? It would surely make the ghost of that Hollywood fight crowd that used to cram into this glorious pit very, very pleased indeed. They come out here to see the likes of Henry Armstrong, Barney Ross, Sugar Ray Robinson, the Ramuses, the Ortizes, Archie Moore, many, many others. Who are those Hollywood stars? Well, how about Chaplin, Gable, Raft, Al Jolson? And legend has it that the Marx Brothers would jump into the ring to entertain the crowd between the fights from time to time. Also, this is the venue where almost all of the old Hollywood fight films were staged. Just one other historical note. Oscar De La Hoya's father and grandfather fought here. Three generations of fighters in an arena that has spanned three generations.
So it's only appropriate that we turn to our own individual generation spanner, former heavyweight champion George Foreman. George, before we get a look at Oscar De La Hoya, we're going to take on the business of James Toney, the IBF super middleweight champion, who regards himself as the best pound-for-pound fighter in the sport, not Evander Holyfield, not Pernell Whitaker. Toney says it's him, and some experts agree with him. In your view, how good is James Toney?
He may well be one of the best fighters around today, but the question tonight is, has he a manager equally as good as he? Scouting referees and judges. Sometimes when you move up in class with opponents, your manager has got, can't be a freshman. She's got to have everything on the ball.
So you're saying that among the matchups here tonight is not just James Toney against Tim Littles, but Tony's manager, Jackie Callan, against the Duba organization, which has long represented Tim Littles.
And they scout boxing well. They'll do their job behind the corner, behind the ring, behind the scene. They do it with professional persistency. They are the greatest at this point.
Yep, but don't sell Jackie short. She's gotten James this far. We've told you the story before of the inner rage that drives and motivates James Toney, but there's a new element in his personal landscape, as you're about to learn right now.
Like that. Like that. Bam! Bam!
Love and hate. Powerful emotions that influence our lives each and every day. For James Toney, love and hate are large parts of what he has accomplished and what he wants to be. Like too many American children, James Toney grew up without knowing his father. His father abandoned James and his mother when he was 17 months old and left Toney with just one thing, an anger that still rages today.
When he get out, I got something for him. I can't guarantee he'll walk away. If somebody piss me off, they gonna know about it. Every time I see red, that means you're dead.
Words directed toward the father James never knew, the man who now tries to reach him from the Ohio prison where he serves time for rape, the man whose face he sees in each and every opponent he meets in the ring, the man who fuels the hatred James has felt for too long.
You can only imagine how it would be to be a young boy growing up, and there's Boy Scouts and father-son events and all kinds of things going on at school and in your everyday life, and you're so left out of that because you don't have a father. And you don't have any male role model in your life at all. And I know he resents it, and I'm sure he's very bitter because of it, because that's a big loss. That's a whole part of a person's life that was cut out of his, and he can never get it back.
He never can get it back. But does James understand that?
Well, I think by now, after this length of time, it's time for him to grow up and lay this deal about his father, lay that on the side, and think in terms of doing something with his life and don't worry about what happened in the past. That's gone.
Recently, another side of James Toney has been exposed, one driven not only by hate, but also by love. The birth of his daughter last year forced James to temper his anger with newfound purpose and to fight the natural urge to react to adversity with rage.
It has changed in a lot of ways. I said, James, you can't do what you used to do. You have to think now, because it's not just you anymore. When you think now, when you want to do something that's not right, you got to think for yourself and also her. Because you do something that's detrimental to your future, it's going to hurt her.
James Toney knows all about being unwanted. He knows the feeling of living life without a father. And he knows he never wants his daughter to be hurt the way his father hurt him.
It's better than having a world title, you know. She's the most important thing in my life. Besides my mother. So, you know, it's great every time I see her, look at her and say, that's me, that's a part of me. And, you know, everything I do reflects, you know, on her. So I gotta be careful what I do and say.
James Toney trains these days with a new sense of direction. He's inspired by the prospect of seeing a future far brighter than his past.
I'm much more hungry. Because, like I said, when they fight me, it's like them trying to take food off a plate. You know, he's like trying to change her lifestyle, and I don't let that happen.
While he couldn't stop his father from leaving him as a child, James Toney now finds himself in complete control of his life. He, too, is in a position to greatly shape his child's future, but he has a much different idea of how to go about it.
My mom keeps telling me, you can't buy it, she's not big enough for this yet, but, you know, I'll do it anyway because that's something I never had. And I wanted to grow up having everything, you know. Everybody says she's been spoiled since the first day she's born. You know, so she's spoiled. She'd be probably spoiled for the rest of her life. But, you know, hey, I love it. I can do that.
So when the champion steps into the ring tonight, he will still be motivated by hatred for his father. But now that hatred shares space in his heart with a different, even more powerful urge, unconditional love.
Okay,
And now the father leaves his dressing room to enter the ring, closely accompanied by the woman to whom George Foreman referred in his opening comments, manager Jackie Callan, who says her ambition is to be the first lady of boxing. And a proper ambition it is in this building tonight, which was, for 40 years, run by a woman, a grand impresario named Aileen Eaton, who truly was the first lady of boxing.
And I think it's appropriate, Jim, that James Toney is fighting the first main event here, because he is a throwback to old fighters. This is his 17th fight since he won the title less than 3 years ago. And you have to go way, way back in American champions to Sugar Ray Robinson and people of that era to find champions who were that active.
And as we're going to show you, the net result of all that activity is that among all of the undefeated champions in the alphabet soup of boxing, none of them has fought or won as many fights as this man, James Toney. There are, in all, 13 undefeated champions in the sport, and Toney has been the most active of them all. And once again, the record 41 wins, no losses, two draws. The most memorable victory, the one that gave him his first title, the middleweight crown, the come-from-behind, left-hook, one-punch knockout of Michael Nunn in Nunn's hometown of Davenport, Iowa. He hasn't shown that much finishing power since then, although in his last fight, at 179 pounds as a light heavyweight, he knocked out Anthony Hembrick. The opponent tonight is more of a boxer than a puncher, Tim Littles. There's a little bit of a regional war here, because while Toney grew up in Ann Arbor, Michigan, Littles was growing up in Flint. He was a terrific amateur fighter, had a much bigger reputation at that time than Toney, and you can see he's also unbeaten at 24-0, 15 KOs.
Little known fact, as an amateur, he beat Michael Moore, who will fight for the heavyweight championship next month, twice.
Since that time, Littles has remained at just about the same weight, and Moore, as you know, has put on more than 50 pounds. Tale of the tape for these two fighters. And you can see that Littles is slightly the rangier of the two, although James Toney, a little bit surprisingly, has a 4-inch reach advantage. In the past, he used to struggle to make 160 pounds. Here, he weighed in 1/4 pound under the 168-pound limit, which gives him a 1.25-pound weight advantage over Littles. Punch stat numbers, Larry.
Here are the profiles of how active these fighters are. And while Toney is obviously the much more accurate puncher, the more economical puncher, all those punches that Littles throws, he hopes will help him defensively tonight by keeping Toney blocking the punches. And that again is reflected in the number of jabs that Littles throws. It's for him a defensive as well as an offensive weapon.
Rules of the bout with our unofficial ringside scorer, Harold Letterman.
James Toney and Tim Littles will box tonight using the rules of the International Boxing Federation. 12 rounds. There is no standing eight count, no three knockdown rule. He cannot be saved by the bell in any round, including the last round. The referee or the doctor can stop the fight. And in case a cut is caused by an accidental headbutt, and that cut causes the fight to be stopped, we go to the scorecards after six rounds have been completed. Before that, it's a technical draw.
Jim. All right, right now, let's go up to the ring announcer, Michael Buffer, for the pre-fight introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, and welcome to the grand reopening of the Grand Auditorium, the Grand Olympic Auditorium here in the City of Angels, Los Angeles, California, where tonight Bob Arum's Top Rank Incorporated, along with the undisputed, undefeated King of Beers, Budweiser, proud to be your bud, presents World Professional Championship Wrestling, pardon me, boxing for your entertainment. This bout is sanctioned by the International Boxing Federation, along with the California State Athletic Commission. California Chairman William Eastman, Vice Chairman Willie Buchanan, Commissioners in attendance at ringside, Kim Wilshans, Jerry Nathanson, and former welterweight champion Carlos Palomino. Executive Director Richard DeCure. Physicians at ringside, Dr. Robert Carnes, Dr. Perlman Hicks, and Dr. Adam Carnes. The timekeeper is Debbie Garcia. IBF Supervisor ringside, Marion Mohammed. The scoring for this bout will be done on a 10-point must system, and the three judges assigned will be Gary Merritt, Paul Weitzel, and Fritz Werner. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, referee Pat Russell. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from the Grand Olympic Auditorium, here in Los Angeles, California, for the first of two world title bouts, let's get ready to rumble! Well, rounds of boxing for the IBF Super Middleweight Championship of the World. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the aqua trunks with black stripes, weighing in at 166 and one half pounds. He comes to us from Flint, Michigan. His professional record, undefeated, 24-0, 15 KOs. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the challenger and number one ranked super middleweight in the world, Doctor of Style, Tim Little. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the black trunks with red trim, weighing in at 167 and three quarter pounds. He's fighting out of Ann Arbor, Michigan. He also is undefeated. On his way to two times a world champion, he's 41-0, two draws, 27 KOs. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the IBF Super Middleweight Champion of the World, James Lights Out Toney.
James, Tim, any instructions? We've covered all the situations and rules. Do you have any questions? Do you have any questions? 12 rounds championship fight. Let's go.
In the last 4 months, Jim, Riddick Bowe, Terry Norris, Julio Cesar Chavez, Michael Carbajal, some of the biggest names in boxing have all lost their titles. Can James Toney hold on to his?
The primary strategy confrontation here. Toney is often accused of being lazy and fighting only in spurts. It is said of Toney he only fights one out of every 3 minutes in most rounds. Virtually all of Tony's opponents have said, I'm going to pressure him, I'm going to make him fight every minute of every round, I'm going to wear him out. Littles said it yesterday. No one has succeeded yet.
Best thing for Little is to stay relaxed. He started off relaxed, not trying to land his punches with too much power, but just keep the points coming.
Littles is known to be a busy fighter, but he connects on a low percentage of his punches. And Toney is hard to hit, one of the toughest targets to find in the sport.
One of his defects, Toney, he'll land one good body punch and wait to see if it hurt. You can lose a lot of rounds waiting for quicker hand fighters like Little.
It's called admiring your work, and lots of fighters do it. Right, George?
That's what you do. And he's a puncher. He's been in with bigger guys the last few months. That's not going to help him.
Toney often at his best against an attacking opponent who will give him a chance to counterpunch. I personally don't believe that Tim Littles is going to be able to be the attacker here.
There's no way. There's too much power and strength in Tony's shoulder. Once you bump into those shoulders a couple of times, you automatically decide to move backwards.
Littles cautious so far in round one, sticking mostly with the jab. Toney waiting for an opening and, as is typical, resting from time to time.
And Toney has to be careful. Once Little touches him two times, he's got to go out and touch him three more times. You just can't be behind on punching.
In a couple of his fights, Tim Littles has averaged more than 100 punches per round. His output here in round one will not approach that.
That was that good body punch by James Toney, but he still waited to see, did it hurt? Another good body puncher right to the body by Toney.
In his last appearance here on HBO in the undercard of Morrison Bent in Tulsa, Oklahoma, October 29, Toney said that he could tell in the first round against Toney the punching postman Thornton that he wasn't going to be able to knock him out and would have to settle for a decision. Wonder what he's thinking of Littles right now.
Yeah. At some point in your life, you got to realize that you got to slow down the power and just get accurate, land more punches. Don't try to knock everybody out.
Tim Littles opening up a little bit there and throwing a couple of overhand rights. He has a tendency, when pressured, to slap with his punches. We haven't seen that yet here.
Little is pretty good. He keeps his body moving left, right, left, right. Never, that head and shoulders never in one spot long enough.
Primary voice in James Toney's corner is trainer Bill Miller.
Good first round. All right. Eventually, if we can get this guy to lead a little more, we can count on him, especially them right hands. Once we can take the right hand away from him, and the left hook. In the meantime, this is the key. He popped him with that jab. That was a good first round. Stop it.
Round two approaching. James Toney threw only 18 jabs in round one to 47 jabs thrown by Tim Littles. So Littles trying to set the pace, be the busier fighter, and perhaps get ahead on the scorecards early.
Toney's strategy, laying a lot of body punches. That's good if you're going to look for a knockout in a lot of rounds. But if you want to keep up on points with an experienced fighter, you got to have more points also.
Toney loves to talk big. He promised us a knockout yesterday. It's not the first time that he's done that. Lands a right hand over the top. Littles reaching with the jab. James Toney, a very patient fighter.
He was able to land a good straight right hand, Toney was this time. This may give him a little added and maybe too much confidence too early.
Body punching by Tim Littles, a good idea. Right hand by Littles, right on the button.
Sometimes you just don't think that a guy is number one contender because he's thinning out envelope. Sometimes they're good fighters, and Little is nothing to play with.
Hey, you've got to respect this guy. He's a sensational-looking athlete, if nothing else.
Toney may be saying, I've been in with bigger guys. I've been hit harder. Believe me, little guys can knock you out.
Right hand by Toney in the counter situation there. Landed flush. And James dances a little bit to celebrate.
Little is starting to go too high on top with his right hand. Toney's coming under.
Too high and too wide. He's got a tendency to wing his punches sometimes, George, and it's already starting.
But believe me, Toney has already tasted some power there, so he's going to respect him a lot more than you would think.
But if there's one thing James Toney has shown in the past, particularly in his best performance against Iran Barkley, you go wide with your punches and he'll come up the middle and hurt you.
That's true. Toney is trying everything to roll the right hand and come back with a left, roll the left hook, right hand and come back with his right hand of his own. If Little is able to throw that right hand and hook behind it, he can drop Toney.
Another solid right inside by Toney as they exchange punches in the middle of the ring there. Little's wobbled for just a second.
Good body punch, square in the middle of the stomach. This is something that normally doesn't happen until a latter round. Toney is landing good body punches too early in this fight to make you think it's going to go for a long time.
Another counter right by Toney. Littles is leaving the left hand out there, and James is coming over the top of it. Now there's a left by Littles.
Okay, you see, he was pounding his right hand. All I want is to pick up the left hand a little more with them jabs. Pick up them jabs a little more. The stiff jab. Pick it up. But he was pounding his right hand. When you make a miss, you make him pay.
There's that big right hand that lifted Toney off one leg early in the round. Toney has a habit of ducking away from the right hand and trying to ride it out. But Littles got there before the ride started.
All right. So jab,
Watch your heads inside. I love you, sir. All right.
Let's keep this stiff
hand up.
Biggest surprise so far from our punch stat computations. First two rounds, Tim Little's landed 49% of his power shots. So Toney, normally hard to hit, has been more open than he'd like to be tonight.
Mainly because he's been fighting bigger guys who he's been quicker than. This time, he's going to be the short end on the stick. He's not as fast as Little.
Counter right inside by Toney again. Littles has to be careful to get that left hand back after he throws the jab.
Not only that, Little is starting to get a little flat-footed. He should keep his movement a little bit more into his shoulders.
Jabs by Littles. That time, Toney countered with an uppercut. Landed again. So accurate with his counterpunching, George.
And he throws his jab and keeps it in position to automatically cover himself up afterwards, Toney.
Littles kind of half-hearted with the right to the body there. Should have committed more to the punch.
Little at this point is starting more to protect himself more than going out there to take a title from someone. Toney still has the same strategy, waiting for a weak right hand to counter it with. Came awful close to getting that right hand in.
You get the impression Toney is happy to throw one punch to Little's three as long as it's the right punch at the right time.
Yeah, and that, you know, and that's kind of critical because judges sometimes don't understand power. They don't know that Tony's punches hurt more than Little.
Good point. When in doubt, most judges will err on the side of the busier fighter, right?
That's true. Toney is trying to counterpunch at this point when he should be building up a point system. He's gotten his power punches in now.
Both fighters landing there. Littles still showing an ability to be accurate with power shots. Left hook wobbled Littles. Toney thinks he has him in trouble. Opens up just a little bit. Plenty of time left in round three.
Little right hand for the first time went behind Tony's left shoulder, which is showing that Toney has got his timing perfectly down now.
Tim Littles is losing his legs here in round three. James Toney's got him in trouble. 37 seconds left in which to try to do some damage. Littles in serious trouble now. Toney trying to choose his shots and down goes the doctor.
They're up on me, Jenny. Hey, how we doing? Give me your hand. All right? Let's go.
He doesn't know where Toney is.
First time Tim Littles has ever tasted canvas in his professional career. This is his 25th fight. He's in serious trouble now as Toney tries to finish. Littles can't be saved by the bell. He's going to make it out of the round.
That was Toney at his best.
And he's bleeding. Toney has been cut.
I think he might have caught some skull in there.
That's a very, very bad cut over the eye. He's going to have to go out and try to end this fight as fast as he can.
That is almost certainly a headbutt cut, Larry.
There you saw where Toney started that rally in the middle of the round that took him to the close. We'll have to see if we can catch where the butt or the punch came. In California, they can take a timeout and bring the doctor in, which they are right now. It is not beyond the realm of possibility that this fight could be stopped.
They can't stop it after that round.
In which case, I believe it would be a technical draw. I'm not 100% sure.
Harold Letterman.
Jim, the rule is this. If the fight is stopped and the referee says that the cut was caused by a punch, Tim Littles wins on a TKO. If he says it was caused by a headbutt, it's a technical draw.
Let's hope referee Pat Russell knows and is secure in his own mind as to exactly where that butt or that cut came from. I think it had to be a headbutt, but I don't want to leap to too many conclusions. Littles goes down again.
This is highly dramatic, Jim. This is very dramatic stuff. That cut is so bad, I can't imagine the fight going on very much longer for Toney.
I totally agree.
I can't imagine Lou Duva allowing his fighter to get caught with so many hard shots this early in his career.
Look at the purposefulness of James Toney as he once again puts Little down. It's got to be scored a knockdown, and it will be.
Six, seven. Hey, how are you? Good. All right.
And remember, there is no three-knockdown rule in effect for this title bout. So Littles can go down again without being automatically eliminated.
Of the historic performance by Sugar Ray Leonard, by Sugar Ray Robinson, excuse me, way back when he was cut late in the fight and had to go out and knock out and score a knockout to win.
This came
against
about
Randy Turpin.
Toney knew that if this fight goes 12 rounds, the probabilities could be against him. He knew a knockout was his best bet tonight, and he got it.
Tremendous drama as an unbeaten champion. The one unbeaten champion with the most fights and the most victories of any of the 13 currently active in the sport found himself bleeding badly from a deep, deep cut over his left eye, desperately in need of a knockout, and produced it almost on demand.
For the first time, there was no lazy Toney. This was pure boxer, fighter.
There were three knockdowns in this round. Let's take a look now at each one of the three knockdowns. And, George, you tell us what James was doing.
Right now, he's gotten time and he's gotten behind and throwing those right hands because he knows this guy's not accurate anymore with his counterpunching. Good right hand drops him, going under, and now trying for the finish.
The uppercut there landed on the point of the chin. Down went Littles. That was the second knockdown. Now here's the third.
You try to hold on, but this time Toney knows, look, I cannot go another round and try to wait and finish this guy. It's got to happen now. I'm not going to quit. I got to keep throwing punches until he hits the canvas. If I don't, they can stop this fight because of this cut.
There was a solid right there against the ropes, which was the punch that convinced Pat Russell to stop the fight. Now we're going to see where the cut came from, and there it was. It was a headbutt. You saw their two heads bash together there, and it was from that point forward that Toney was in serious trouble with the blood streaming from above his left eye. Look at that cut, George.
And for the first time, Toney will have to take a long rest to heal. So his activity will slow down a bit now. Sometimes it's for the best. You go out and give your best, take a rest, go to Europe.
That's a great point. This guy has been, as Larry Merchant pointed out before the fight, the most active of all champions, fighting on an average of once every 2 months or so, much more active than other title holders in the sport, and now a little enforced R&R is in order. And right now, let's go up the ring and out to Michael Buffer for the official particulars.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Pat Russell calls a halt to the bout. The official time, 1 minute and 3 seconds of round number four. The winner by technical knockout and still the undefeated IBF super middleweight champion of the world, James Lights Out Toney.
Final punch stat numbers, and you will see that Toney turned the tables in the last round and a half, winding up with a 48% connect percentage to only 27% for Tim Littles. Littles barely landed a punch in those last minutes of the fight, only landing the serious headbutt that cut Toney above the eye, and James landed power shot after power shot to put his man down and out. Larry Merchant compared it to Sugar Ray Robinson's dramatic comeback decades ago against Randy Turpin. Right now, Larry stands by with the champion in the ring.
James, congratulations. That was a wonderful performance. Were you aware of how bad the cut over your eye is?
No, I didn't. Oh, Lord have mercy. Well, I didn't know how bad the cut was. The only thing I know, I came out to the corner. Bill was like, we got to stop this guy right now. Can't take no more chances. I was like, oh, man. When I seen the blood running down, I seen red. It means he has to die. And you see what happened to him. Everybody back in Flint, I told you, he's a bum. I beat everybody out there. Can't nobody mess with me. Hey, Kevin, you well, baby. I love you.
James, have you ever been cut like that? How did you know how to respond?
I've been cut before. Same thing, headbutt by Reggie Johnson. And I got up and whooped him up. So, you know.
So you knew it was a headbutt?
Yeah, it was a headbutt.
Now, the doctor told me that he was very close to calling off the fight. Why don't you describe what's happening here?
Right now, this is the last round, right?
Yeah.
Well, right now, I knew I had to get him out of there, so I stepped on him. I wasn't taking no chances. Over that right hand right there, had his legs on shaky ground. He's trying to hold on for dear life. He threw a little desperation punch right there. He didn't land.
Well, that's where the butt came in. I'm sorry. I guess that was the third round. My mistake, James. But did the doctor say anything to you in the corner?
Yeah, he said, we'll give him one more round. I said, oh, hell no. He can't take it away from me like this. I'm going out there to get him. If I see my blood, that means the guy got to die.
So you knew that you had this one round to finish your business.
And I was going
to
go do it, and I did.
Well, that's rare and unusual and quite wonderful and a memorable fight. What are your thoughts now about the future, James?
Well, I think I proved out there I'm the best fighter pound for pound in the world today. You know, I did something to everybody, Julio Chavez, Terry Norris, Michael Nunn. They can't be like me. They want to be, but they ain't me.
Who do you want to fight in the future?
I'll fight anybody. Roy Jones, whoever. I'm the best. I'll take on all comers.
I don't think you have too many challengers out there saying that you're not the best.
I'm ready for anybody. Come on. I'm the man. I'm the man.
Thank you, James.
I'm the man.
Back to you, Jim.
George.
I don't think anybody's going to argue with him. Just to clarify and confirm, I don't know whether Larry has given you this information. Referee Pat Russell assured our Harold Letterman that he had already determined that the cut was the product of a headbutt. Had he been forced to stop the fight, James Toney would not have been in danger of losing for the first time in his career. We'll take one more look at the sequence of events which brought an end to the fight. It was that right-hand punch which left Littles almost unconscious, setting up the left hand there. Russell stopping the fight before Littles had even tasted the canvas for the last time. George Foreman, you said before the fight that you agree with Toney he may be better than Pernell Whitaker, as good as Pernell Whitaker, best pound for pound in the world. He's even better than we thought he was.
I've often said if I had another boy, I would have to name him James Toney. This is a good fighter. He fought a good fight. He had a wake-up call tonight knowing that he could lose this title by being lazy in any fashion. He went out there and went to work like he ought to.
There aren't too many fighters who could have been as precise, as purposeful, and as economical with their punches as he was in that situation, right?
He looked like the top fighter that he should be recognized as tonight. He's a finisher, which he hasn't been putting on those kind of shows lately. He showed tonight, I can hurt you and finish you.
All right, and just to underline the drama one more time, we reiterate that the doctor told our Larry Merchant that only one round would have been remaining for Toney to make his point, that if the fight had gone on much more, then he, the doctor, was going to stop it to bring an end to the bloodshed. So all the pressure in the world was on James, and he came through. James Toney retaining his IBF 168-pound championship. We'll take another look back at that before the evening is over, but right now, let's prepare ourselves amid this star-studded crowd here in the Grand Olympic Auditorium for the second of tonight's two main events from L.A. Tonight, from the entertainment capital of the world, it's Oscars night. Nominated for Best Live Action, Oscar De La Hoya, for his action-packed attack in throwing over 60 punches per round. And nominated for Best Original Score, once again, Oscar De La Hoya, for scoring 10 knockouts in his 11 professional fights. And nominated for Best Performance, you guessed it, Oscar De La Hoya, for averaging only 3.3 rounds for each performance. Live from the Grand Olympic Auditorium in Los Angeles, HBO Sports presents Oscars Night as undefeated Oscar De La Hoya faces Jimmy Bredahl for the WBO Junior Lightweight title of the world. And just as will be the case less than a month from now on Academy Award night, all the stars are on hand here. First name basis for all of you who know them so well, Jack is here. And, of course, Sugar Ray, now a resident of our fair city here in Los Angeles, here and seated in the front row. And not too far away from him, the noted amateur boxer, Ryan O'Neal. And Billy Crystal. Check it. Gary Shandling, I should say. Excuse me. Sorry, Gary. My apologies. The Larry Sanders Show itself, doing a live segment from here at ringside. So we get ready now to join the continuing career of boxing's newest young sensation, the man whom Bob Arum says has a chance to become the biggest of all the big stars in the sport, 21-year-old Oscar De La Hoya, America's only Olympic gold medalist coming out of the Barcelona Olympic Games in the boxing competition. Larry Merchant, the promotional material for the fight, says that Oscar De La Hoya has a chance to win his first world championship. And the layman might say, wow, at age 21 in his 12th professional fight, he's fighting for a title. Is he being rushed into a title bout?
He would be, Jim, if this were a championship fight. If this was a toe-the-line, no doubt about it, fight for the best man in the division in the world. But as Ali used to say, we're not as dumb as we look. We all know what this is about. And this young fighter isn't ready yet to soar to the top of the mountain. He is a terrific prospect, Oscar De La Hoya. He's one of those golden boys who comes out of the Olympics, and we all want to watch his progress. But a championship fight, Jimmy Bardal is a good young fighter who might make a good opponent at this stage of De La Hoya's career. But is he a champion, or is he just the champion of the Tivoli Gardens in Copenhagen? Nothing even that lofty. What he's the champion of, Jimmy Bardal, is the WBO. And the last WBO champion we had was Tommy Morrison. I rest my case. If Jimmy Bardal is just a good Dane, not a great Dane, just a good Dane, we could get a fight, and I'll settle for that.
Jimmy Bardal comes in, a virtual unknown from Denmark. De La Hoya, of course, is already on the verge of becoming a household name. But George Foreman, the golden boy image has been tarnished a little bit in the last couple of months. He's taken over, in effect, management of his own career. Is it a bad idea?
I think the golden boy image has been uplifted because young people got to take control of their own lives. Stop blaming other people. Oscar De La Hoya said, if I can take the punches, I can control the pain. I think it's wonderful. Any young man can. He's showing the world I can.
So I ask if it's a bad idea, and you think it's a great idea.
I think it's a wonderful thing. Young people, your mom and dad send you away to college. Be a man. Be a woman. No more mom and dad.
That's the step that Oscar De La Hoya has taken. He himself says he's gotten a rapid education in the hard realities of the boxing business. It all started 2 months ago.
It was very tough to let go of two people that were trying to help out my career. It was very tough.
Oscar De La Hoya dropped out of a fight last December, and after a messy public dispute, he fired his co-managers, pictured here, Steve Nelson and Robert Middleman.
I believe it was the right move because now I can focus and just stay focused 150% in my boxing and accomplish what I want to accomplish.
After De La Hoya's sensational gold medal performance at the Barcelona Olympics, Nelson and Middleman dangled a million-dollar contract before Oscar's eyes. And quickly, he signed. But it didn't take too long before he learned, not everything that glitters is gold.
One of the reasons why we didn't agree on things is because they didn't keep their promise.
They were always going to be a little bit strapped for cash because their million-dollar promise was not... They didn't have $1 million in their pocket to hand to him. They were always a little bit late with the money.
Oscar and his managers never quite connected culturally either.
The chemistry was lacking between Oscar and his people on the one hand and Bob Middleman and Steve Nelson on the other.
It was all hectic because they would come up with different ideas and we would come up with different ideas and it was just tough.
You have two guys from New York who are not... do not have Latino connections, do not speak Spanish, a little bit in your face, then he's got people who come to him who speak Spanish, who have Latino ties, maybe say, hey, these are just two white guys from New York just messing your career up. They're taking 33 1/3% of your money off the top, and you don't need this kind of hassle.
So De La Hoya broke free from Nelson and Middleman at the cost of a settlement payment close to $2 million. Oscar now manages himself, in cooperation with several influential members of the Los Angeles Latino community. He still listens to his father and his trainer.
Now, is he in control of his career? We'll see. Is this the right move? He better win his fights. What he is doing is heaping the burden of his career upon his own shoulders.
While some praise De La Hoya's maturity for undertaking the tough job of putting his own house in order, others detect a troubling pattern.
I don't think anyone who saw what happened with Shelley Finkel, anyone who has seen him through his career, should say that this is a shock, that this was, God, how could this have happened?
Evander Holyfield's manager, Shelley Finkel, had subsidized De La Hoya's lengthy amateur career, even paying for his mother's funeral expenses. Finkel was thought to have a lock on De La Hoya after the Olympics, until Oscar suddenly accepted Middleman and Nelson's pie-in-the-sky offer.
Steve Nelson and Bob Middleman offered Oscar a very, very attractive deal. And they went for that Oscar went for that deal.
Since then, Finkel has sued to recover his expenses. And with two jilted management teams now in his wake, what are we to make of Oscar De La Hoya's loyalty?
Hey, what's that, huh? Illegal.
Remember, Oscar has just turned 21. He's very young. He's also inexperienced in the art of business, inexperienced dealing with people.
I'm barely starting my boxing career. I'm like a little chicken inside an egg, and I'm barely hatching out. I'm glad that everything is settled, and all I have to do now is just focus and train and win.
Question: does this episode signal the arrival of a savvier, more stable Oscar De La Hoya? Or is it evidence that his unstable business relationships will continue? For now, one thing is certain. Oscar has run out of managers to dump out on. He's left with only himself. And here he comes, walking for the moment alone from his dressing room. Far behind him, trainer Robert Alcazar, regarded as perhaps the biggest beneficiary other than Oscar of the recent change in management circumstances, because Alcazar felt that the previous managers, Nelson and Middleman, might be trying to steer him out. And one of the points that Oscar wanted to make is that he prefers to keep Alcazar as his trainer long into the future.
The question about this young man, Jim, is having put all these pressure and all of these expectations onto his own shoulders, can he live up to them? The great ones turn those things into opportunities.
Part of the pressure tonight, he'll be fighting before almost all of his friends and family members. He won the gold medal in Barcelona, defeating Marco Rudolph of Germany in the gold medal bout. He parades around the ring with the American flag in one hand, the Mexican flag in the other. The record, 11 wins, no losses, 10 KOs in the only bout which went all the way to decision against Mike Grable in Rochester, New York, back in April of 1993. In eight rounds, he put Grable on the canvas seven times. So he has shown punching power in every single one of his bouts. His opponent tonight makes his way from Denmark by way of Tyler, Texas, where he trained for this fight under the tutelage of his American trainer, Al McCoy. Jimmy Bridal, 16 wins, no losses, has not shown a lot of punching power to this point in his career. His brother, Johnny Bridal, is the WBO junior bantamweight titleist. And if you recognize the WBO as a legitimate title-granting organization, which we don't, then you would say that Johnny and Jimmy are the only brothers currently holding boxing championships. But once again, we regard the WBO as a paper organization, and we don't see this as a legitimate world championship bout.
Now, that's not me. That's you.
I know that, George.
George Foreman is not interested.
And George there's the man with the Danish flag.
George Foreman had to beat Joe Frazier to win a championship, George. That was a championship.
We mentioned Bridal's record, 16 wins, no losses, only 5 knockouts. If he has a tactical advantage here tonight, it would be that he is a southpaw, and De La Hoya has not fought a lot of them as a professional, though, of course, in De La Hoya's amateur career of more than 200 fights, he saw more than his share of southpaws.
He's quick, and he's clever, but if he presses the attack as he told us he would, he may be quick and gone.
Indeed, it's hard to imagine him following the fight plan he described of getting into De La Hoya's face and pressuring him from the opening bell. Tale of the tape, De La Hoya not enjoying the head or more height advantage here, which he has held against most of his other opponents. He weighs in at 128 and 3/4, fighting at 130 pounds, and a lot of people believe, Larry Merchant, that that's a big mistake, that he ought to be at 135 or more already, and he's squeezing himself to get into this weight class.
Well, sometimes a young athlete can overcome all of his mistakes with talent, but I don't understand why a fighter who fought at this weight 3 or 4 years ago, before the Olympics, is back down to this weight instead of getting stronger. Puzzlement to me.
Bunch stat numbers, Larry.
Here you see that both fighters are about as active as each other. De La Hoya much more the accurate puncher. And once again, the challenger or the champion of his WBO is a very active jabber.
And weren't we happy to have Harold Letterman's trusted guidance through the rules in the last bout? Give them to us again, Harold.
Jimmy Bridal and Oscar De La Hoya will box tonight using the rules of the World Boxing Organization. 12 rounds. There is no standing 8 count, but the 3 knockdown rule is in effect. You can be saved by the bell in the last round only. The referee or the doctor can stop the fight. And if a cut is caused by an accidental headbutt, and that cut causes the fight to be stopped, we go to the scorecards after 3 rounds have been completed. Before that, it's a technical draw. Jim.
For pre-fight introductions, again, Michael Buffer.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we celebrate the return of boxing to this legendary arena, we must pause at this time to honor a great warrior who passed away last week at the age of 80. Like the great fighters who appeared here in the Olympic Auditorium, he was a man of great courage and heart. He always gave 110% and he never gave up. He proved this in 1951 in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. It was his 5th and well-deserved chance at the heavyweight title. He came out for the 7th round, threw a picture-perfect left hook, and 10 seconds later he was heavyweight champion of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, as we welcome a new era of boxing here at the Olympic, we must bid a farewell to a grand old champion. At this time, please rise in silence. Please rise in silence for a final farewell, a memorial count of 10 for the former heavyweight champion of the world, Jersey Joe Walcott. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, Top Rank Incorporated, along with the undisputed, undefeated King of Beers, Budweiser, proud to be your Bud, presents professional championship boxing for your entertainment. This bout is sanctioned by the World Boxing Organization and the California State Athletic Commission. Chairman for California, William Eastman, Vice Chairman, Willie Buchanan, Commissioners of Ringside, Kim Wilsons, Jerry Nathanson, and former World Heavyweight Champion of the World, Carlos Palomino. Executive Officer, Richard DeCure. Physicians at ringside, Dr. Robert Carnes, Dr. Melvin Hicks, and Dr. Adam Carnes. The timekeeper for this contest is John Lichty. WBO Supervisor ringside, Francisco Farcacel. WBO judges assigned, scoring the bout on a 10-point must system are Jess Andreasen, Raul Caiz, and Huiso Fernandez. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, referee Lou Moret. And now, ladies and gentlemen, once again, part two of the grand opening of the Grand Olympic Auditorium here in the City of Angels. Let's get ready to rumble! Twelve rounds of boxing for the WBO Junior Lightweight Championship of the World. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the gold trunks with black trim, weighing 128¾ pounds, from East Los Angeles, California, undefeated with a record of 11-0, 10 by KO. He's the 1992 Olympic gold medal champion. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the undefeated challenger, the pride of East LA, the Golden Boy, Oscar De La Hoya. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the red trunks with white trim, weighing 130 pounds even, from Copenhagen, Denmark, also undefeated, his record 16-0, 5 KOs to his credit. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the undefeated WBO Junior Lightweight Champion of the World, Jimmy Breda.
Oscar? Both fighters, Jim, look like they could use a good square meal or two.
I don't like to see a guy come into his hometown smiling so much before a fight. Oscar, no too many smiles.
That first fight was right out of one of the movies they used to stage here, Jim and George. I wonder what Oscar De La Hoya can do to top it or match it.
Well, the stage has certainly been set by James Toney. And now the challenge is there for De La Hoya. Solid right hand to begin round one. No evidence that Bridal is ready to pressure De La Hoya as he claimed he was.
De La Hoya surprised me. He's throwing one punch at a time.
Well, maybe he's been lured into thinking of himself as a knockout artist, George.
Yeah, you can't do that. You got to stick to what gets you over. Set up everything behind a jab. Then throw numbers.
Oscar is naturally left-handed, but fights from a right-handed stance. It's the lightweight inverse of Michael Moore, a natural right-hander who fights as a southpaw in the heavyweight division. What it means is that his lead hand, his jab hand, is also his strongest and best hand. Finishes every combination, if he can, with a left hook. It's probably his most dangerous punch.
The younger guys, when they are good punches, have a tendency to taste the guy's power.
Oh, look at the grin from De La Hoya as he drops Bridal with one right hand. And that's the first time Bridal's ever been on the canvas. And Bridal is looking at De La Hoya with a look that says, don't get too cocky. But I'm not sure Bridal is strong enough to be in the ring with Oscar.
Is a great finisher.
This could be over fast. No action in return from Bridal as De La Hoya fires away with both fists. What a show.
Oscar's a great finisher, but you've got to respect an opponent. He knows that 12 rounds is where the fight could go.
Feet already as De La Hoya tries to cultivate his image as boxing's baby-faced killer.
Believe me, if Oscar wins this title, the WBO will suddenly be the place.
Well, maybe at 130 pounds. Although there's evidence that his managers were steering him away from one of the three existing titleists from the other organizations, Genaro Hernandez.
Oscar's forgetting to jab and set things up, put it all back together like he did from the first.
Expectations are so high, and this round has been so impressive that the crowd may be mildly disappointed if he doesn't produce a first-round knockout.
And Oscar's only landed one body punch. When you throw away a lot of energy like that, you've got to invest something back into the body.
Riddle makes it out of round one.
Early in the round, left himself open and caught that straight right hand. It was more of a flash knockdown. He was composed throughout it, got up, and survived the round.
Trainer Robert Alcazar with a final pat on the back for De La Hoya as he goes out for round two.
Oscar started back to the body, which was great. Go to the body. You've not had a knockdown. Now invest in making this guy lose his power for the latter round.
And as you watch for signs of the future champion in De La Hoya, the return to body punching at the beginning of round two is about as good an omen as you could look for.
He was hurt this time, Oscar was.
He's been knocked down before. He was knocked down by Narciso Valenzuela in his last fight, October 30.
Oscar's got to remember, he got that flash knockdown when Braylon was pressing him. He didn't get it by going after him. He's got to make him come to him again.
Left hook snapped Friedahl's head to the side.
Good
right hand again. Yep. That's a punch you can land against a southpaw if you throw it at the right time.
Oscar's got to allow him to come forward a little bit to be more accurate with that shot.
Friedahl trying a left hand lead. Didn't commit to it too much. Probably felt too much leather already. De La Hoya backing him up with the jab.
Now the best thing has happened. Oscar's starting to use his left jab.
Boy, he is strong for this weight, George.
Bridal is no chump. He takes a punch and he tries to get up and get a few more in.
Well, he's very cocky. He thinks he's terrific. And he thinks he's fought better fighters than Oscar De La Hoya, although the list of opponents is pretty anonymity. Yep. Here we go. Riddle down again.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You okay?
Yes, sir.
Good.
Plenty of time left in round two.
Oscar's got to be patient. Set this thing back up.
Three knockdown rule is in effect in this fight.
But they have to come in one round, Jim.
That's right. Solid right hand.
A lot of leaping by Oscar. If this fight goes beyond six rounds, he may have to pay for that.
Wouldn't mind seeing more body punching, would you, George?
That's the only way you can ensure that the guy doesn't have his power left in a lot of rounds.
And the final flurry from De La Hoya as round two comes to a close. Crowd beginning to get its money's worth here. Well, in fact, let's face it, they already got their money's worth in the Toney drama.
Let's see if we can catch the fight where he initially staggers Breedall. It appeared to be the first left hand, followed by that last right hand that hurt Breedall. As you can see, Oscar De La Hoya is a picture boxer puncher.
And the hand speed blur as he throws those combinations. Shades of Sugar Ray Leonard seated in the front row at ringside.
Thing that troubled me, Oscar's landing a lot of good shots, but they're hitting the gloves of the champion a lot more than hitting the target.
Breedall trying to be more assertive as round three begins. He's been knocked down in each of the first two rounds.
Champion Breedall has tasted the best power that Oscar has at this point, so his confidence can do nothing but grow now.
Straight left hand landed for Breedall. De La Hoya trying to go back to the right hand lead, stalking, but properly cautious for the moment. Just misses with the right.
This time Oscar should do some faking, feinting they call it. Move your hand, trick him.
Right hand landed for Breedall. Oscar answered with a left. Body punch. Sets up a right hand that almost got him. Didn't quite get there. Slapping with the left, but now a hard right hand and into the ropes goes Breedall again.
Okay.
Crowd thinks referee Lumaret was a little hasty in breaking him up.
The
chant you may hear from time to time is East L.A., East L.A. Largely Latino community where De La Hoya grew up.
Good left hook by Oscar De La Hoya. But at this point, he's putting too much power into every punch. You got to pace yourself in these lighter weights.
And he's deteriorated to one punch at a time. Combinations only when he feels the chance to move forward like there.
Oscar would only fake that jab down to the stomach a few times and then start his punches.
Interestingly, Breedall had promised us a lot of body punching, saying that he didn't think De La Hoya had proved himself as one who could take it to the ribcage yet. But Jimmy hasn't been able to go to the body much because he's been defending himself too much, George.
That's right. He's starting to switch hit now. He turned from left to right, southpaw to left-hander.
And a quiet round three comes to a close. As we go to Oscar De La Hoya's corner, our interpreter is Hector Garcia.
You're doing very good. Keep working that way. You're doing very good. Just keep working that way. Keep your hands up and keep moving. Rest a little bit. Very good. There's no problem. Just keep working. We only need just a little bit of time. That's all we need. Keep working.
It's great to see a young fighter looking so perfect, so unblemished his mind uncluttered by doubt.
If you're going to be a good pro in the lighter weights, you're going to have to learn to pace yourself in these rounds. One third into the fight, third away, you've got to start jabbing. Just keep your lead. You get a second win a little later on to finish him off again if you can.
You think Oster's in control of that, George?
I don't think so. He's walking forward. Sometimes the right foot is bumping into his left foot, crossing over once.
Riddell landed a left hand in there. Another left hand gets in just under the chin. De La Hoya reaching now.
De La Hoya's feet are starting to catch up with one another. You're never supposed to let your right foot catch up with your left foot.
Is it a sign of overeagerness?
Yep, and it's the time of you following a guy around. Boxing is defense at all times. Defend yourself at all times. Don't walk into a trap.
The manly art of self-defense. There's some serious self-defense. A couple of hard shots landed on Riddell there, and Jimmy elects to get in a hug to set himself up again.
A lot of frustration by Oscar. He's doing the right things. This guy's just not going down right. Frustrating for a puncher. When you go for someone's title, they're not just going to hand it to you.
But logic tells you that De La Hoya is piling up a lead on the scorecards here. Stamina could become a factor if the bout goes a long way. De La Hoya has never been farther than 8 rounds. Riddell, on the other hand, has gone past 10 rounds 3 times.
Oscar may have to say to himself, this fight may go the distance now. Let me beat him decisively.
I don't think that's what he's thinking, George.
Well, the young guys, it's hard to tell them that some guys just can't knock them out because you're hitting them in the head.
Good body shots from De La Hoya.
Let's go, don't push.
Again, the crowd thinks that Moret is too solicitous of open ring action. Shouldn't have broken him up quite so quickly. This is the ultimate hometown crowd.
Sometimes that hometown crowd can push you to do things that you ought not to do.
Oh, remember Holyfield getting in trouble in Atlanta against Bert Cooper? Michael Nunn getting himself knocked out in Davenport, Iowa against James Toney?
You try to go out and do too much to impress your buddies, and hey, just win. That's all that counts. If you're going to be a good champion, you've got to use your jab. Left jab.
And that is another heavyweight champion. Ex-heavyweight champion Ingemar Johansson, who pulled off one of the biggest upsets in boxing history when he knocked out Floyd Patterson in the third round 35 years ago. He's here covering this fight for Scandinavian television. Harold Letterman, how do you score the fight so far?
Larry, 4 rounds to nothing. 40-34, Oscar De La Hoya. At this point, Oscar is chasing him from East L.A. to East Copenhagen because Jimmy Breedell is doing nothing but running away. I mean, Oscar deserves an extra point in rounds 1 and 2 for the 2 clean knockdowns. Certainly won rounds 3 and 4 easily. He's got a big 6-point lead at this point.
I have it the same way. He has turned, De La Hoya has turned Breedell from an opponent and a fighter into a survivor.
I just got one question, Larry. If he gets knocked out here, is he still the champion of Tivoli Gardens in Copenhagen?
I suspect he is.
In 4 rounds, our punch stat numbers tell us that De La Hoya has landed 41% of his blows. Riddell, only 19%.
Riddell believes that he's still in this fight, that in the latter rounds, Oscar will tie.
Right hand got up underneath De La Hoya's guard. Riddell working hard to try to follow up with the left hand. Missing wildly, but Oscar knows he's in there.
Hold it. Break it. Come on.
That's a willing piece of aggression by Riddell. That's the pressure he promised. Problem is, it'll get him too much of this.
Break him.
expects Friedel to impale himself on De La Hoya's fists.
And they're outraged when he refuses to do it. Great right hand landed for De La Hoya, so did the left. But Friedel was moving away.
Friedel instinctively should, as soon as Oscar finishes slowly, jump right back on him. He's not fighting like a guy who really wants to keep his title. Is looking down at the body, tipping his hand, what he's trying to do.
Telegraphing his body punches, huh? Oh, left hand inside.
Shouldn't let a guy know what you look thinking.
Well, of course, he's got those big liquid brown eyes, George, which Madison Avenue believes will sell billions of dollars worth of products.
And I believe as much too. This guy is a good representative of young people. And he tells me to buy something, even if it's perfume.
You can get that for your wife, Joan.
Yeah.
It's okay. De La Hoya pacing himself a little bit. As round five comes to a close, I think he's accepted the notion now that it's not an easy knockout.
Yeah, he's bouncing.
Deepen nails way up, Oscar. Run that into your leg.
Rest a little bit. Just relax. Breathe in pretty heavy. Incidentally, in case you're wondering who that gentleman is whose head is festooned with HBO insignia, among other things, that's cutman Chuck Bodak, and he's not from this planet.
How did he get loose?
Keep working that way. You're working very well. Cut that ring. Cut that ring.
You gonna pick it up this round.
We thought we might get a long first fight and a short second fight. Shows to go what we know.
Round six begins. The end of this stanza would be the halfway point of this scheduled 12-round bout.
If the champion is going to do it, he's better come on right now. Fill up. Take it to the judges and win a few of these rounds. Good body punch.
Existing 130-pound world championships are held by Genaro Hernandez, Azuma Nelson, and John Molina. As you watch De La Hoya go to work again to try to finish Friedel, we'll point out that it's highly unlikely his management would ever let him near a fighter like Azuma Nelson at this stage of his career. They seem to have dodged Genaro Hernandez for the moment, and De La Hoya has sparred, with John Molina in the gym in the past. He says he always got the best of Molina.
Friedel should charge him right now and win this round.
There's blood from Friedel's nose.
Blood below the left nostril for Friedel.
Oscar's got this bounce in his legs now. This is confidence for a young fighter when they do that. They're very confident. I can go on all night.
He's chasing Friedel. Is he doing a good enough job of cutting off the ring, George?
He's not cutting off the ring at all. He's following him, but he's bouncing along with it, which is a sign when you got young fighters, if they bounce, they're happy.
When they stop bouncing, they're sad.
But this cutting off the ring deal is one of the hardest things for a young fighter to learn and remember, right?
That's right, because you got to make the ring a small place. When you let a guy circle the whole ring, you've missed the boat.
And this, incidentally, is a spacious ring.
Vidal is able to move from one corner to another. You cut it off by leaving him one corner and don't allow him to leave that corner.
A parenthetical observation, gentlemen. From the dressing rooms, we learned that James Toney has had 12 stitches put into the cut above his left eye. It's the most stitches that Toney has had in his career. And they're deep, too.
It's very, very hard to look good against a fighter like Vidal. And I think this young De La Hoya is doing a good job of trying to look good against him.
Round distance.
Okay, but you never go when I tell you, right?
Okay. Give me some grease. You're okay. Give me a drink.
Only 85 punches between the two fighters in round six. That's an incredibly low output for Vidal, who spent most of the round simply running away from De La Hoya.
You can do it. You can box and box the shit out of him. You're being fucking
look for any signs of a cut on Vidal. It didn't appear that there was one, so that blood which we saw under his nose was probably a trickle from the nostril.
If Vidal is going to win this fight at this point, he's got to search for a knockout.
If Vidal is going to win this fight at this point, George, he's going to have to get NATO involved, I think.
I don't know if the British and the French want to go to war here.
Not against De La Hoya. Now the crowd chants, Oscar, Oscar, Oscar.
Oscar's got to remain calm and forget about the crowd.
Well, at least Vidal is staying close enough now to give him some opportunities. He knew he'd try an uppercut. He kept staying that close, and he landed the second uppercut flush.
Oscar's strategy has been to keep winning each round, and the strategy has paid off thus far.
Yeah, he's about 100 points ahead at this point.
Vidal is starting to land short right hooks.
Oh, there's a solid right hand from De La Hoya. Vidal steps in, goes to the left, to the body.
Right clean.
Vidal much more aggressive in this round. His confidence seeming to return gradually. There's another De La Hoya flurry. Right, left, left. Vidal thinks he got thumbed in the eye.
Vidal is extremely fast. You see him a minute, and next thing you know, you throw three punches. He's out of range.
Hold it.
You are so gracious. You have this amazing capacity to find a way to compliment a fighter who is losing badly in a one-sided fight. I love it, George. What a heart beats within this massive body of yours. Straight up the middle, De La Hoya.
De La Hoya uses his left jab. There's no contest. And it looks good.
You know, this thing about telegraphing punches with his eyes, George, he might benefit from looking at some videotapes of James Toney, who's a master of looking in one place and hitting you in another.
That's correct. De La Hoya's going to hit you in the body. He looks there first.
Left hand landed inside for De La Hoya. King Vidal up again as round seven comes to a close. Another one-sided round in favor of East Los Angeles' Olympic gold medalist, Oscar De La Hoya.
Oscar, ese hombre, termínamelo con la izquierda, okay?
Finish him up with the left hand, Oscar.
Termínalo con la izquierda. Está trabajando
finish him up
bien
with the left hand.
Está entrando muy
he's,
bien.
He's working now. He's working pretty good, but you have to get him.
Descanse. Rest. Descanse, Oscar. Respire.
Breathe
okay.
in.
Respire, Oscar.
Breathe in.
Está trabajando muy bien.
You're working very relax, good. Relax. Okay.
Harold Letterman, how do you see it through seven rounds?
Larry, seven rounds to none, 70 to 61. Oscar De La Hoya, based on clean punching, effective aggressiveness, ring generalship, defense, artistic impression, and technical merit. I mean, anything we score on, Oscar De La Hoya is winning all the way around.
My scoring must be improving, Harold, because I agree with you.
So Oscar De La Hoya enters the eighth round for only the second time in his career. Only once before has he gone this far. That was against Mike Grable in Rochester, New York, April 6, 1993, almost a year ago. Vidal says, let me hold you. I like it better that way.
Watch the head! Watch the head! Watch
the great Carlos Palomino watching at ringside across the way. He had a couple of terrific fights. Now, De La Hoya believes he's been butted by Bridal, and referee Lou Moret allows him to get his bearings before they start again. Lead right by De La Hoya. Bridal backs up. Left hook! Left hook! And to the body. A little bit of a mean streak from Oscar, and Moret says, hey, don't hit him in the liver when I'm breaking you apart like that.
Sometimes it gets awful frustrating, especially if this is a southpaw, so that punch to the side like that wouldn't have been like that if it had been a left hand, right hand. You're doing everything you can, and you can't get a knockout. You're young, you think everybody's supposed to fall.
One more time. One
Oscar's
more time
energy boiling over here. Okay. Referee Lou Moret becoming increasingly unpopular in Los Angeles.
He's having to keep order in that ring.
Is he doing the right thing, George?
He's doing the right thing. Oscar's at home. He thinks he can do anything he wants, but at the same time, a referee, he's got to be equal in his judgment towards it.
Did Oscar do the right thing to pop the liver when he had a chance?
No. He wouldn't have.
It was a foul, right?
It wouldn't have been. It wouldn't have happened if Vidal had been a right-hander. His body is on wrong. He made it look like he was hitting him in the back. When you look down, it's over. It's too late then.
An angry Oscar De La Hoya inciting the passions of this big crowd. A near sellout in the new Grand Olympic Auditorium. Since 1925, the beating heart of boxing on the West Coast.
Hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it.
What a night.
The way they move in synchrony, there's times here when I think I'm watching Torville and Dean.
But they only got bronze. De La Hoya was golden. Let's look down the road just a moment now. World Championship Boxing will return next month with a welterweight doubleheader as, yes, Pernell Whitaker, considered by most experts boxing's best pound-for-pound fighter, defends his WBC crown against number one-ranked contender Santos Cardona. Also featured, two former champions face each other when Buddy McGirt takes on Livingston Bramble, live Saturday, April 9, from Norfolk, Virginia, on HBO. Note the unusual starting time, 9:45 Eastern, 6:45 Pacific.
There's the danger of a long fight like this. Anything can happen. And there you saw a butt that got De La Hoya in the eye and rankled him a bit. damage.
So this now becomes the longest fight of Oscar De La Hoya's long career. More than 200 amateur bouts, 11 as a professional. This is the first time he's ever had to go past 8 rounds. Round 8 was another pitiful output for Jimmy Bridal, who only threw 19 punches in the round. You can't be busier than that. You're just leaving too many opportunities for De La Hoya to get off.
Oscar has to be in extremely good conditioning to be able to throw that many punches and even miss from time to time. Still have the eye of a finisher.
Well, we're going to find out what kind of conditioning he's got, George, as he now goes into closing rounds.
Bridal is not going back after him when Oscar finishes his rally. Get right back on him.
De La Hoya trains at altitude in Big Bear, California, in the San Bernardino Mountains. His friends and trainer Robert Alcazar say that he is an eager trainer, boxing's version of a gym rat. He's been doing this since he was 6 years old. We asked De La Hoya yesterday what other sports he played as a child. He said none. I was boxing all the time.
Oscar's got to be careful when he throws his right hand not to take his body forward. He could get cut like Toney did.
Bridal is not too fond of De La Hoya's right hand lead. He's begun to back away as soon as Oscar cocks the throw.
Oscar's a sitting duck charging in. That left-hander's head is just missing his head each time. One butt, and that could be a bad cut.
We've already had one butting of heads in this fight that could have produced a cut. Didn't do so. In case you joined us late, in our first main event of the evening, we had scintillating drama as James Toney, bleeding badly from a cut over his left eye caused by a headbutt on the part of challenger Tim Littles, rallied to score a dramatic knockout of Littles in a fight that would shortly have been stopped had Toney not been able to get the finish himself.
This fight has become an anticlimax to the first fight and the first two rounds of this fight.
When you come out of there, you go down, don't step straight back out. That's where he catches you. He's coming over your right hand with a hook, okay? All right. Now you go out to this sandbox and let your hands go. Let your hands go, okay, baby?
Come still.
Keep your right hand up.
Breathing hard. You're working very well. You're working very well. Just keep working that same way. You come out first. You come out fighting first. Don't wait for him. You go first.
Okay. In the big picture, this is a useful fight for De La Hoya. He's going to go the distance with this opponent, apparently. Keep him working hard. What did I just say?
Don't worry, Larry. You were just dreaming it. You didn't say it.
Hey, you okay?
Sure? Maybe Bridal has had enough of this.
Yeah, it looks that way to me. Yeah. Third knockdown of the fight. The others came in rounds 1 and 2. Bridal looks utterly weary. And referee Lou Moret has to be thinking stoppage pretty soon if De La Hoya continues this onslaught.
Hold it. Let him go. You okay, Jimmy? You okay?
Again, the crowd says, Lou, why did you stop him? Remember, these three knockouts knockdowns represent the first time in Bridal's 17-fight career that he's ever been on the deck. And he, of course, has never been knocked out, unbeaten coming into the fight.
Oscar lands one shot and throws four more anyway. That's the sign of a great champion.
Here in the corner. Didn't do it.
He allows him to circle and circle and circle.
Well, that's something to work on for sure.
But then a lot of it is because he's a southpaw. The champion is a southpaw.
He's also very good at circling.
That's the truth.
Lead right hands, and he might go from a not-so-great Dane to a melancholy Dane.
He just was not prepared for the power of Oscar De La Hoya. Weighing in at 128, but believe me, he's punching like 147.
Seconds left in round 10. How much more of this does Jimmy Bridal want? Can he find an opening to do some damage himself? No, he'd rather grab and hold for the moment.
He's a gutsy kid.
You can't see, you can't breathe, and the referee asks, are you okay?
Round 10. And Robert Alcazar acts as though the fight is over as he races into the middle of the ring to embrace his charge. Now the doctor steps into the corner to take a look at Bridal.
He almost stopped one fight already, and he may be stopping this one.
No.
In California, either the referee or the doctor can stop the fight. And the doctor here says, enough. And you know what? Bridal doesn't entirely disagree. So Oscar gets his TKO. In Bridal's corner seemed to center on how much punishment he had taken, and Jimmy's answer seemed to be, I've taken a lot.
Are you okay? The ref continues to ask. No, I'm not okay.
That's the wrong answer.
Thank you very much.
So De La Hoya moves to 12-0. Those who recognize the WBO, the World Boxing Organization, as a legitimate title-granting organization, and for our purposes, that would make four in the sport. So officially here at HBO, we don't acknowledge them. But those people who do would say that De La Hoya has now won the first of his world championships. He says his goal is to win titles in six different weight classes. That was the reason for fighting for a title at 130 pounds, so that he can ultimately win titles at 130, 135, 140, 147, 154, and 160 pounds. Let's take a look back at some of the punishment from the last round, George. Here's the knockdown.
So many punches landing in the same part of the face each time. That comes back with one each time. It's hard to recover.
Now here's the big right. Boom.
That can be frustrating. You land a shot like that and the guy's still on his feet.
Yeah, but that's the kind of punch that makes the doctor say, I'm not sure I want to see what happens if he lands it again. Right now, let's go up to ring announcer Michael Buffer for the official particulars.
Referee Lou Moret, acting on the advice of physician at ringside, Dr. Adam Carnes, calls a halt to the bout at the end of round 10. The winner by technical knockout and new WBO Junior Lightweight Champion of the World, the Golden Boy, Oscar De La Hoya.
Final punch stat numbers. And you'll see here the statistical evidence that convinced the ring doctor that he'd seen enough after 10 rounds. De La Hoya landed 242 punches to only 77 for Bridal. Connect percentage of 43% for Oscar. One out of five punches landed for Bridal, and none of them did much damage. Oscar De La Hoya showing hand speed, combinations, a little footwork, power. There's not much missing, is there, George?
He's got it all. He's got the making of possibly the best pound-for-pound fighter around. Possibly. I don't want to get into arguments with Toney, but
yeah,
this guy's good.
Let's see him against some tougher opponents before we call him that. But right now, Larry Merchant stands by with De La Hoya.
Oscar, congratulations. First, did you see Toney's fight? Did it have any effect on you? Did you want to do better than him? What was your impression going after?
When you have a fighter who is good at like James Toney, and he puts on an excellent performance. He did very, very good. It puts you more pressure, so you could try harder and make you want to show off more and make the audience cheer more for you. So it did add a little more power to me. It psyched me up more, and my game plan was very good. I felt very, very strong. Okay, he's a very well talented little boxer, and I give him a lot of credit.
Why? What was the difficulty of following up on your knockdowns? Was he just tough and quick?
Well, a softball is really difficult when you go in there and try to throw your punches. You're so used to fighting a right-handed boxer that when you fight a left-handed boxer, it's like it's a whole different game. It's a whole different plan that you have to sort out up in the ring, and that's what happened. But I caught him up in later rounds.
Let's take a look at the last knockdown in the 10th round. Which ended the fight, really. Tell us what you see.
I was just putting a lot of pressure to him. He couldn't just stand the pressure because I felt very, very strong. I felt that I was in command, and it was just a matter of time that he would go down and lose the fight.
Now this is the end of the fight. Did you punch enough to the body in this fight, Oscar?
I really couldn't punch to the body a lot because of his left-hand style. But later on, I started to throw the right hook to the body, and they kind of worked, but I knew that I had to throw different punches, come up in different angles to win the fight.
What kind of feelings and impressions do you have about following your father and grandfather into this arena and fighting here?
Yeah, well, first of all, I would like to thank the Needleman family and Mr. Bob Barron, the best promoter in the world, to having given me this opportunity of reopening the Grand Olympic Auditorium. And it was just a great honor for myself because my father fought here, my grandfather fought here, and now for me to fight here is just the best thing that could ever happen to Los Angeles and myself.
Do you feel that you still have to win over the hardcore, skeptical, tough fans in East Los Angeles?
Oh, most definitely. I mean, fans are never going to be happy. People are never going to be happy. There's always going to be positive and negative critics out there, and I feel very, very confident that in the future, I will come up against the best fighters in the world, and hopefully I will do well, because this is my first year in boxing, and I just have to develop more strength and more endurance and just physical strength that I need.
You fought at 130 pounds. You weren't sure whether you'd be comfortable here. Do you want to stay here, or do you want to move up?
I felt very strong. I felt very powerful and fast. I believe, see how it goes maybe in 3 weeks, see how I feel. If my body grows into a lightweight, or if I'll move up higher, I don't know.
Will you fight some of the outstanding fighters in your weight classifications here in Los Angeles, like Genaro Hernandez and the Relis brothers? And since you're managing your career, you're telling us, you tell us what your timetable is.
Well, my timetable is to develop a little more experience, and eventually I'll be fighting the best in the world, from Los Angeles, from anywhere in the world, and I just need a little more time, and only I know when I've developed that strength and power to beat any champion out there.
Well, at least for tonight, you were an excellent manager as well as a fighter. Thank you, Oscar De La Hoya.
Thank you, sir.
And back to you, Jim and George.
All right, Larry, exactly the point I was going to make, George. Swimming against the tide, as always. You've said that you think it's an excellent idea for Oscar to manage himself. He did a heck of a job of it tonight, didn't he?
Yeah, he did a great job, and it's going to tell the world that young people, just because you're young, you're not dumb.
How close is he to being able to take on the very best in these lightweight classes, e.g. Azuma Nelson and Genaro Hernandez?
Well, there's no way we could have seen the best of Oscar De La Hoya tonight. He was against a southpaw. Put him in the ring with a right-hander, you're going to see the best, and this guy will impress even the most skeptics of skeptics. He is a great fighter, and he's got a great future in boxing.
All right, let's bring Larry in for some final thoughts here right now. Larry, if you'll just step over here and join us. George has offered that De La Hoya offers a sparkling future. Your final thoughts about both fights here tonight?
Well, we came in here saying, I think accurately, that the building was a star tonight. But I also think that the two winners were stars as well. James Toney gave a performance that I don't think could have been topped any time in the glorious history of this arena. It was truly one of those dramatic performances that becomes the marker of a fighter's career. And I'll be curious to see how fans respond to him from here on out. And in Oscar De La Hoya, we did see a great young fighter. And I thought his comments after the fight about taking his time were appropriate and shows that he's got a head on his shoulders for more than just the fighting in the ring. We came in wondering, I did anyway, whether you can turn nostalgia into reality. And I think at least for one night, we did.
Just like in the movies. Well, don't leave us yet, boxing fans, because we've got a treat coming up. In a moment, we'll interview the man who next challenges for the heavyweight championship of the world. But first, a word about an upcoming original movie here on HBO.
Inside a maximum security prison.
Nobody's got a legitimate bitch unless I say so.
There are some things they can't teach you.
This is the training program.
There are some things they don't tell you.
You don't run this joint, they do.
Now, you people are turning into a problem again, my friend.
And the only rule to live by is...
Well, how you gonna deal with the problem, Mr. Superintendent?
Be ready.
We have an inmate control problem here. Officers are down.
Has anything changed in the prison system? Is anything going to change?
Let it burn!
I'm going to negotiate this all the way.
It's my officers' lives you're negotiating, goddammit!
You're running out of time, Mr. Superintendent.
This is Attica.
We're not gonna blink.
Kyle MacLachlan, Samuel L. Jackson, and Clarence Williams III against the wall. Attica. 39 men die. The story never will. An HBO original movie premieres Saturday, March 26th on HBO.
Hey, he's going to give me the first shot.
Against the Wall, that's this month on HBO. Next month, April 22, this man, Michael Moore, challenges Evander Holyfield in Las Vegas for the WBA and IBF World Heavyweight Championship belts that Holyfield now holds. Michael, welcome to the telecast. Have you already begun training for the fight?
Yes, I have. I've been in training for about a week and 5 days, so I'm feeling pretty confident about this fight.
You've had various changes of manager and trainer in the past. When we saw you last here against Mike Evans on HBO, you were being trained by Teddy Atlas. Does he stay in that position for the upcoming title fight?
Yes, he does. A lot of people make a big deal about changing trainers, but I think it's all within the fighter. I'm too strong-minded to let it bother me or affect me.
You're the mandatory challenger, but there are a lot of people who thought that Evander might try to get around that to go ahead and try to unify the heavyweight championship against Lennox Lewis. Are you surprised that he's giving you the opportunity now?
I'm not surprised. I remember him stating that he wants to fight the best, and I think that I am the best, and I think he knows that, but he wants to prove to himself. But I think it's going to be a fatal mistake, actually.
What are your advantages against the champion?
I don't know if there's any advantages. I know myself, I'm younger, stronger, more determined.
Well, those people who say that Evander should be favored in the fight will, on the other hand, say that you have a puncher's chance. It's boxing language for saying that Moore is a guy with so much power that he might score a knockout against Evander, even if Evander is tactically better. Do you think that you have that kind of one-punch power against him?
Absolutely, but you have to take your hat off to Evander. Evander is a true champion and is a strong-minded person. I think it's going to come down to being within the minds, I think, because, you know, you can't get in the excellent shape of your life because anyone can be hit and get knocked down. but you have to be the true champion to come back.
You're pointing out now that you accurately predicted that Holyfield would take the title back from Riddick Bowe, seen by most people as a huge upset. Why did you think he was going to be able to do it?
It's like I stated, he's too strong-minded and too determined, and he really believes in himself. So that plays a key part in boxing, I believe.
You're telling me you have more respect for Evander than for any other fighter you've gone into the ring against?
Well, I respect everybody. As long as you don't disrespect me, then we don't have no problems.
I don't want to disrespect you, Mike. You're known for your mean streak. You'll never find me on your enemies list, I hope. We're looking forward to seeing you on April 22, and thanks very much for joining us.
Appreciate it.
Michael Moore, the man who will be challenging Evander Holyfield for the World Heavyweight Championship in Las Vegas on April 22, a pay-per-view bout. So earlier tonight, James Toney here in the newly reopened Grand Olympic Auditorium in Los Angeles scored a dramatic comeback TKO over Tim Littles after the challenger had opened a huge cut over Tony's left eye with a headbutt. The doctor confirmed he would shortly have stopped the fight if Tony hadn't been able to get the knockout. It was scintillating stuff. And then Oscar De La Hoya, before the wildly enthusiastic home crowd, many of them from his neighborhood of East Los Angeles, finally got the TKO at the end of round 10 after knocking down Jimmy Bredahl three times, the first time De La Hoya has fought 10 rounds, the 12th victory of his career, the 11th by knockout, and he remains golden and unbeaten. Coming up immediately following tonight's coverage of World Championship Boxing, stay tuned for Nowhere to Run on the East Coast and Groundhog Day on the West Coast. World Championship Boxing returns next month with a welterweight doubleheader as Pernell Whitaker, considered by many to be boxing's best pound-for-pound fighter, defends his WBC crown against number one-ranked contender Santos Cardona. Also featured, two former champions face each other when Buddy McGirt takes on Livingston Bramble. That doubleheader live Saturday, April 9 on HBO. So now, for Larry Merchant, George Foreman, and Harold Letterman, I'm Jim Lampley saying so long from Los Angeles, California. The executive producer of HBO Sports is Ross Greenberg. Tonight's coverage of World Championship Boxing was produced by Rick Bernstein and directed by Mark Payton. The feature producers were Adam Berger and Kirby Bradley. Associate producer, Brian McDonald. Assistants to the producer, Dave Leibson and Artie Curry. Production manager, John McCallie. And the technical supervisor, Bob Hunter. Of HBO Sports, the network of champions.
Pound for pound, we all know who the best fighter in the world is. And Pernell Whitaker is back to prove it in a World Championship Boxing doubleheader. Whitaker versus Cardona, McGirt versus Bramble, live Saturday, April 9th, only on HBO.